scrap embedding. So in order to know what graph embedding is, we need to know what graph is and embedding is. So probably all of you guys know what graph is, but let me just define it to be sure. So we say that H is an object which consists of vertices and edges. Then we call it a hypergraph. It's say K uniform hypergraph. If this B is a finite set, and this E, H, is a collection of K element subsets of this B. So when I write this B choose K, so this indicates all the subsets, collection of all the subsets of B which has size exactly K. So this H is a collection of sets which consists of vertices. And especially we say that the two uniform hypergraph are graphs. And usually when we draw it, we put these dots for the vertices and we draw these lines for the edges. So for example, x2, x3, x4, then this consists of these four vertices, which is B, and this E is the collection, collection of sets such that first set consists of these two vertices, and second set consists of these two vertices, and these two vertices, and these two vertices. And let's say this is H, and then we have some other graph, say G. V1, V2. Let's just say this way, V1, V2, V3, V4, V5. So this is also a graph. And when we say embedding, what we mean is that if you see these two graphs, and then if we think about this structure, let's say we consider these four edges, then they look exactly look like H. Right? So this G has some substructure which looks quite similar to H. In that case, what we say is that this G contains this H as a subgraph, or H embeds into G. So more precisely, we say that if there exists an injective map, say pi from the vertices of H, so this indicates the B of H indicate the vertices of H. So in this case, H x1, x2, x3, x4 to vertices of G such that each edge maps into an edge. So this E of G indicates edges, sets of edges of G. So for every edge XY in H, its image also induces an edge in G. Then we say H embeds into G. We write in this way, or we say that G contains H as a subgraph. So in this case, if we map XI into VI, then that's injective, and that satisfies this condition. For every edge in H, its image also gives us an edge in G. So that's what is called an embedding. In this case, we say that H embeds into G, and this specific map, pi, is what is called embedding. So what we want to do is, let's say for given some H and G, we want to figure out whether H embeds into G or not. Especially, we want to find some condition The goal of this lecture is to find some condition which guarantees an embedding of H into G. So find conditions on, say, G. We will fix H first, and then we try to find the conditions on G, which guarantees an embedding of H into G. So what kind of condition are we looking for? So if you think about this, so in order to get an embedding, we need this condition. For every H here, its image must be an H. So if there are more edges in H, then there are more conditions that we need to make it satisfied. And if there are less edges in H, then that's good for us. There are less conditions. So if H has more edges, then it becomes more difficult to find an embedding. If it has less edges, it becomes less difficult. On the other hand, if G contains lots of edges, then it is easier to satisfy this condition. And if G has less number of edges, then it is also difficult because this is difficult to satisfy. So it's general phenomena that if H is sparse, sparse what I mean is it contains not much edges, then it becomes easier. And if G is dense, if it contains lots of edges, then it becomes easier. So we want to find some conditions on G which guarantees this embedding, then this condition must be somehow making this G dense. So we will think about these two parameters. So E of G is the number of edges. Number of edges in G. Or delta of G, which is minimum degree. So number of edges is just the number of edges. In this case, we count them, then it has 8 edges. So that's clear what it means. And minimum degree is that for each vertex, we count number of edges it's incident 2. So this vertex has degree 3, 3, 4, 3, 3, and we take the minimum, that's 3. So that's this. So we will learn about several conditions on this parameter, which guarantees an embedding of H into G. So that's the goal of this course. And then today, what we will do is we will learn some technique. So one of the tools that we will use for this, to find such conditions is probabilistic method. So today I will introduce some basic probabilistic method. So probabilistic method is a general way to find certain discrete structure that we want to find. So for example, in some proof, we want to find some structure which satisfies certain property. And we want to show that, its best way is to come up with some way to construct it. We construct it and we show that it satisfies the property that we want it to satisfy, then that's the best. But oftentimes that is not that easy. So instead what we do is we consider a probabilistic space of all possible construction, and we show that we design some random algorithm to pick one structure out of this space, and then show that the probability that our chosen structure satisfies a certain property is positive, then that shows an existence of such structure which satisfies the property. So that's the basic philosophy of this probabilistic method. So to illustrate that, let's consider some example. So let's say we define this Ramsey number, say R of H. So H is some graph. Then we say R of H is the smallest n such that in any 2H coloring. Of complete graph on n vertices has a monochromatic copy of H. So what it means is that let's say we, so here K sub n indicates the complete graph on n vertices. What it means is that let's say K5 is 5 vertices with all possible edges between. It is well known that the Ramsey number of triangle is actually 6. So what it means is that when we have 5 vertices, then we can color the edges so that this red, this blue, then triangle doesn't embed into blue graph, and triangle doesn't embed into red graph. But on the other hand, if we have 6 vertices, and these all possible edges, this is K sub 6. And it is not difficult to show that however we color the edges, we always find either red triangle or blue triangle. So in this definition, this smallest n is 6. Because if there is 6 vertices, then we can always embed this H into here. In either in red graph or blue graph. So that's what it means. So one of the first incidents of this probability method is regarding this Ramsey number. So say theorem 1.2 is proved by Erdős that for any integer r, we have this Ramsey number of complete graph on R vertices is at least 2 to the R over 2. Let's say there is no inequality. So one of the easiest way to prove this is using probability method. So what do we have to prove? So for this lower bound, so let's say n is r 2 to the r over 2. To show that this Ramsey number is bigger than n, and what we have to do is we have to come up with a 2H coloring of k sub n, which doesn't contain red copy of k sub r or blue copy of k sub r. So for that, how do we use this probability method? It's first we design some, I mean, we come up with some probability space. So we come up with some probability space, and then we show that if we choose something from this probability space, then we would get what we want with positive probability. So how do we construct this probability space? Is that we consider this n, and consider, say, k sub n. Complete graph on n vertices. And for each edge E of this complete graph, we randomly color E with either red or blue with probability half independently at random. So this is how we define this probability space. So this gives us a coloring of this K sub n. And each coloring is a member of this space, probability space. And then for each one or each subset, we can compute the probability that our resulting coloring belong to that subset. So this gives us the probability space. And then we want to show that with positive probability, the resulting coloring is what we want. But I mean, what we want is that the resulting coloring is a coloring which doesn't contain red KR or blue KR. And then to show that, so say for a set U, which is in this case of R, and which has size exactly R. So again, this means that among this set, we consider all the subsets of size exactly R, and this is one of them. So this is same as just saying that U has size R, and U is the subset of this complete graph. The probability that this gives us a monochromatic case of R is exactly so the probability that U induces a monochromatic, so either red or blue KR is exactly 2 to the minus R choose 2. Because U is R vertices, and then between them we have these edges. How many edges? R choose 2 edges. And that those being all red with probability exactly this, and those being all blue with probability exactly this, and those two cases are the cases that induces a monochromatic case of R. So this is exactly the probability that U give us some monochromatic copy of case of R. Then, what you know is that then the resulting coloring contains a monochromatic copy of case of R with probability at most, we consider all the possible subsets of U which has size R, which is subset of these vertices, and then we add that probability that it becomes monochromatic. So that so we know that when we have we use Venn diagram to deal with the probability in high school. So when we have certain event 1 and event 2, then if we want to figure out the probability that either one of them holds, then it's at most probability of first hold and probability of second hold. Because the area of this part is at most area of this plus area of this, right? So here, the probability that we want to compute is it contains at least one monochromatic copy of case of R. So for each U, we add its probability of, having U as a monochromatic copy, and then we add them together, then that's upper bound, just like here. So this is what's called union bound. And then if we compute that, then how many such set U we can take? And most N choose R. And then we multiply those together. Then with some tedious computation, we can show that it is strictly smaller than one. So what it means is that the resulting coloring contains at least one monochromatic copy of K sub R with probability strictly less than one. That means there exists some probability that our resulting coloring doesn't contain any monochromatic triangle. Monochromatic case of R, sorry. That means there is certain coloring in this probability space. There is certain coloring which doesn't contain monochromatic case of R. Right? If there was no such coloring at the beginning, then there is no way that we can get positive probability. So this implies that there exists an edge coloring. Of k sub n without monochromatic copy of k sub r. So that shows this lower bound. So this is one typical example of how we use the polarizing method. And here the key fact we use is this union bound. That if we have one event and the other event, and we want to estimate the probability that at least one of them holds, then we can find the upper bound just by adding the probability of each of them holds. So what we first want to do today, as I mentioned before, we want to find some condition on G to guarantee an embedding of H into G. And first, what we want to do is we want to consider complete graph as an H. So if H is a complete graph, then when can we embed into G? And condition on which one? Let's say we first condition this number of edges in G. Let's say G has n vertices. So we will consider this. And let's say K sub R embedded into G is actually same as G complement has an independent set of size R. Here, G complement is a graph which we obtain by flipping all the edges and non-edges. So for example, if G is, say, this graph, then G complement, so here, these are edges, 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 edges. So here, it must be non-edge, 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 non-edge. And here, this is non-edge, non-edge, so we flip it to edge, edge. Then, this complete graph embeds into G means that in G, there is this vertex set that pairwise all having all edges there. Then in its complement, they form an independent set. Here, independent set is a set of vertices with no edges inside. So for example, if we have, let's say R is 2, then we have this, K2 embedded into G, if and only if we have this independent set here. So for convenience, let's, instead of considering this, let's consider in this language first. So this question can be interpreted in here, and how sparse G should be to have it, to guarantee an independent set of certain size in this graph. So to explore more about that question, before that, let me just mention several tools in polarizing method that we will use. So we learned about this union bound, which is a useful tool. And another useful tool is linearity of expectation. So, okay, before that, let's define what random variable is. So X is a random variable. If it's a function from a probabilistic space. for example, in the before case, we consider this probabilistic space, and then in this resulting coloring, let's say pi, so we arbitrarily choose this element, and then if we assign certain value here, then that could be a random variable. So if you, I mean, don't concretely get what it means, and next, I mean, later in the example, you will get more idea. And then when we have this random variable, we can consider its expectation. It's something like average. So most easy example is that let's say we have certain number, 1, 2, 3, and if you choose one number at random, then the expectation is exactly the average of this number. So that's the basic intuition. And I will not concretely define what it means. And linearity of expectation is that where there is more than one random variable, and if we add them together, then this is also a random variable. And then expectation of that is exactly the same with expectation of each random variable. So yeah, if you don't get what it means, then later we will deal with some example. So don't worry too much. And let's say one more. It's Markov inequality. Is that the probability that certain value x is bigger than t times each expectation is actually smaller than or equal to 1 over t. So what it means is that so for example, in this case, let's say there are more number, 1, 1, 5. So its expectation is average, which is say 7 over 3, yeah, which is not a good number. Yeah, let's not just do the example. So what it means is that when you have a random variable, it's being too bigger than its expectation has a small, I mean, probability. Because, I mean, if there are large probability of it being large, then expectation also should be higher. So that's the intuition. So those two tools are the ones that we will use throughout the course. So in order to consider, okay, let's leave it here. So, yeah. So let's consider this question. So N and R are natural number with say N is at least R, and N being the say QR plus K with k between 0 and r minus 1. So we will consider this question. If g is sparse, then how big independent set does it have to have? So if we have any n vertex graph g with less than k times q plus 1 choose 2 plus r minus k times q choose 2 edges, then it contains an independent set of size r plus 1. So it has less than this number of edges. So if it's sparse, then it must have independent set of certain size. And where does this number come from? So we consider set of size q plus 1, how many of them? K. And then set of size q, how many of them? R minus K. And then let's say these are complete graph. So inside there are edges between any vertices, and between this crossing there are no edges. Then that contain how many vertices? QR plus K. Every R part contain Q vertices, and K parts only contain one more vertices each. So it has exactly that many vertices. And how many edges does it have? Q plus 1 choose 2, K of them, which contain this much edge. And here, I minus K of them, Q choose 2, all of them. So this many edges. And here, if you choose R plus 1 vertices, there are R parts. R plus 1 vertices, if you choose, two of them must come from the same part by Pigeonhole principle. Then that two vertices has an edge between. So it's never an independent set. So this has largest independent set of size R. So what it says is that in that case, so if this one was equality, then we could have independent set of size R. So we could have not having any independent set of size R plus 1. But if it's less than that, then it must have an independent set of size R plus 1. That's what this theorem says. So how do we prove? So again, we want to use probabilistic method. So there are several ways to prove this theorem, and we will use this probabilistic method to demonstrate certain technique. So let's just say M is the number of edges, so E of G. And what we do is we want to define some probabilistic space, and then we want to define some random variable which give us an independent set. And then we want to deal with its expected size of that independent set to show that there are some independent set which has large size. So for that, what we do is we consider on ordering a sigma, which is from B1 to say Bn of these vertices in G. So we have vertices in G, and we choose an ordering of it. This is small b, which is chosen uniformly at random. So what it means is that there are n factorial possible way of ordering the vertices. And we consider the whole such ordering, so n factorial ordering here, put it here, which is probabilistic space. And then we choose one of them uniformly at random. So what it means is that every ordering is chosen with probability exactly 1 over n factorial. So which is a random variable. And then what we consider is that in this ordering, we consider something called U of sigma, so which is our independent set. And how do we choose it? Which consists of all vertices which comes before its neighbor, before all of its neighbor. Okay. So neighbor is, I'm not quite sure, I didn't define it, right? Okay. So if there is an H between U and V, then we say U is a neighbor of V and V is a neighbor of U. And then what it means is that if we have a graph, say, looks like this, and then we have this ordering, let's say this one is V1, V2, and 3, 4, 5, 6. V6. Then if we consider this vertex, its neighbor is V2, which comes after it. And there are no vertex, none of its neighbor comes before it. So this we choose. But this one, one of its neighbor already comes before. So this one we don't choose. This one, all of its neighbor comes after it. So this one we choose. This one, two of its neighbor comes before it. This one we don't choose. And this one we don't choose. This one we don't choose. So these two, the collection of, I mean, set of those two vertices is use of sigma at the point. And we consider this because, yeah, as I mentioned, we want to consider some independent set. We want to find some random procedure which give us an independent set, and we want to analyze it, its size. That's our goal. Then this, I mean, we choose it this way because this U of sigma is always an independent set. Because if this one was chosen and this one was chosen, and then if it was not independent set, then that means there is an edge between them. Then what happened? Between these two vertices, one of them must be left, must come before the other. Then for this vertex, one of its neighbor already comes before, so which is a contradiction. So if there is an edge between these two, not both of them can be, I mean, can belong to this U of sigma, only one of them. So this U of sigma is actually an independent set. So we build this probability space, and then in that space we choose this sigma, and then that sigma gives us this U. So somehow we choose independent set at random. So we define some random procedure which give us an independent set. And then we want to analyze, which one do I have to keep? We want to analyze this independent set to prove that there are independent sets which have large size. So let X be the random variable, which is size of this U of sigma. So we have this probability space, and then once we choose this sigma, then it's a function, that X is a function. It gives us some real number. So that's what we say random variable. So this X is a random variable. So in order to analyze this, I mean, the usual technique that we want to use is that when we have a random variable, what we want to first do is we want to compute its expectation. And then by using that expectation with certain facts, we want to show that with positive probability, it satisfies certain property that we want. And to analyze its expectation, one of the typical ways, we want to decompose it into a much simpler random variable. And then, because those are simple, we can deal with it. So what I mean by decompose is that we want to write this as a sum of other random variable. And then we use the linearity of expectation to compute expectation of this by computing the expectation of each one of them. So what's this? Then how can we write this X as a sum of more simpler, random variable? So for that, for each vertex in G, we consider an indicator random variable. So indicator random variable is a random variable which has value either 0 or 1. So it's not really important what it's called, but so we consider this I sub v. It's defined that so when we have this sigma, then this is again random variable which give us some number which is either 0 or 1. And when is it 0? If this v is not in u of sigma, and it's 1 if it's in u of sigma. Then it is easy to see that this size is just we take the all the vertices and we add this I sub v. Then if a vertex is there, then we add 1. And if that vertex is not there, we add 0. Then we add them. Then that's exactly the size of this u of sigma. So this is trivially sum of this random variable. Right? And then we can analyze each of them. So for each v, the vertex, what's the expectation of this I sub v? So because it's either 1 or 0, this is exactly the probability that this one is 1. Yeah, we didn't define what's random variable, what's expectation is, but expectation in this case is just the probability that it's 1 times its value 1 here, and probability that it's 0 times 0 here, so we have this. I mean, for if it can have more values, then we add them analogously. So for each, if it's 2, then we multiply 2, and then we add them all together. Or if we deal with continuous random variable, we have to use the integration, but anyway. So this and this are same. And then, what is this? So for example, if we have this vertex, let's say this vertex, and what's the probability that it's included in this u sub sigma? We know how sigma was chosen, right? Uniformly at random among all possible permutation, possible ordering of, these vertices. So this is chosen if and only if this comes before these three vertices. So out of this vertex, out of these four vertices, if this one comes first, then it is chosen. Out of four vertices, if we randomly order them, some specific vertex comes first with probability 1/4. That four comes as you count its neighbors, and then you count yourself. So this is exactly, yep, 1 over its degree plus 1. So we write t sub g of v as a degree of v in this graph g. So this is the expectation of that. Then, let's keep the statement. Then we can compute its expectation of x. So, what's the expectation of x? It's by linearity of expectation, it's same as, let's write it this way. So for all vertices, we add I sub v, then that's x. And because of the linearity of expectation, this is same as this, and which is same as this. So this d of v, I omitted this subscript because we know what that is. So that's the degree. So we want to also compute that. And what we know? We know is G contains less than 10 number of edges. And this is some expression regarding the degrees of vortices. We know there is relationship between the sum of degrees and the number of vortices. So we know that if we say add all the numbers, which is degree plus 1, then if we add all the degrees of the vertices, let's say here, so we add this 2, 1, 2, we count here 1, 2, here 1, 2, then every edge is counted twice. So that's 2m, m is number of edges in G, and we add 1 for each vertex, this is n. And we know that that's at most k times q plus 1 plus r minus k times q minus 1 plus qr plus k. So here what we want to do is we want to show that it's at least something. Because we want to show that the x could be large. We want to find the independent set which is large. And x measures the size of independent set. What we want to prove is x could be large with positive probability. So what we want is lower bound. And for lower bound, if you consider it, so because this 1 over x, this function is convex. So if we make it simpler to understand, if you have a number, say, okay, if we compute 4 plus 4, and then 3 plus 5, then it's always 8. 3 plus 5 is 8, 4 plus 4 is 8. And then if we want to flip it, if we want to take the reciprocal and then add, then this case is bigger than this case. So if we have a certain number whose sum is fixed, and then we want to take quotient and then add, then it's minimized when all the numbers are as even as possible. If it's asymmetric, then its value also gets larger. So by using that, this is minimized when everything is as even as possible. And then what's that case? So because we know its sum is at most, less than this. And then if we write that in another way, so this is same as kq plus r minus kq. So k times q plus 1 plus that. So this is same as kq plus 1 times 2 plus 1. And that is r minus k times q times q. So if we divide this number into n numbers as even as possible, then we get q plus 1 term. How many of them? This is k times q plus 1 of them. And then q terms. How many of them? R minus k times q term. So this number plus this number is exactly n. So we partition this into n numbers, which is as even as possible. Then we get this many q, and this many q plus 1, and this many q. So here, if we make them all as even as possible, then what we get is k times q plus 1 terms of 1 over q plus 1. And then r minus k times q terms of 1 over q. But this is not, this is strictly inequality, right? So it's strictly smaller than that. And if this gets smaller, then this number goes down. This number goes down, that means its reciprocal goes up. So this is strict equality so that this part is bigger. Because m is strictly smaller than that. So this is, if m has exactly this number, then as equal as possible is this. But it's slightly worse than that, so we get this part is bigger. And what's this? This is r. So we show that its expectation is bigger than r. Then what it means? If you have a bunch of numbers and its average is bigger than r, then there should be at least one number bigger than r. If every number is less than or equal to r, then the average must be also less than or equal to r. So that means, let me write in this way. So this implies that there exists a sigma such that the size of this U of sigma has size at least r plus 1. That means there exists an independent set of size r plus 1. So there exists an independent set of size at least r plus 1. So which prove this theorem. And this theorem is sharp because of that example. What I mean by sharp is that if we relax this edge condition on number of edge, even by 1, so instead of less than, let's say, at most, then this is no longer true because of this example. Right? And moreover, not only that, we can actually prove that this is the only example which make it sharp. So what it means is that proposition 1.4 is that if, say, we assume the same thing, let's say this way, and say G contains exactly that many edges, and G has no independent set, of side r plus 1, then G is exactly that graph. So this joint union of k copies of k sub r, k sub q plus 1, and r minus k copies of k sub q. So here disjoint union means that we take several graphs and then we just put them and put no more like edges on, no more edges than that. So this is exactly disjoint union of these cliques and these cliques. So here clique is this complete graph. So to prove this, we can analyze a bit more. So let's say if we have this situation, then what changes is Here, this part is same. And then this part is same. And then this is not strict inequality anymore. This is at least. So, I mean, greater than equal to. Because now we have one more, I mean, possibly one more edge. This is, I mean, not strict. So still, we have that this expectation is at least R. And then what else do we know? We assume that this doesn't contain any independent set of size R plus 1. That means no matter what sigma we choose, the U of sigma that we get, which is an independent set, must have a size at most R. So it's at most R and at least R. So its expectation must be exactly R. Moreover, one more thing we know is that this x must be a constant random variable. So what I mean by constant random variable is no matter what sigma we choose, this x should be always R. Because if not, okay, we have this probability space and there are lots of sigma. And then there is one sigma which gives us x at least R plus 1. Then we are contradiction because we said that there is no independent set. So this doesn't happen. But if there is one sigma which gives us this x at most r minus 1, then this already loses some on its expectation. We know that the average here is r, and if there is one number which is below r, below the average, then there should be another number which is above average. Otherwise, we wouldn't get the average exactly r. So there should be some r which is at least r plus 1, again, contradiction. So this x should be always r, constant random variable. This x is constant random variable. A constant, okay. Then from that, we want to show that this is exactly disjoint union of cliques. So what we want to do is, if it is not that graph, then we want to show that this cannot be constant random variable. So if that's not the disjoint union of cliques, if G is not a disjoint union of complete graph, then what you know is there exist three vertices x, y, g such that xy and xg are edges in G and yg is not an edge in G. Because this is not disjoint union of complete graph, then there should be some non-complete graph. In that non-complete graph, there should be, I mean, if it contains more than two edges and connected, then there should be some two edges which are instant, and between them there is no edge. So I will not rigorously show why it is, but it's believable, right? Yeah. If you thought about it a bit, then it is trivial. Then with that, what we want to do is we want to show that in this case, x is not constant random variable. Then there is a contradiction. That means we must have a disjoint union of cliques. So that's how we want to prove this. And then for this, how do we show that this is not constant random variable? We come up with two ordering which give us the different value by using this property. So we consider this sigma, which starts with x, y, g, and something else. And sigma prime, which comes y, g, x, something else. And this something else part is identical. Because this U is defined as a, I mean, collection of vertices which comes before its neighborhood. Because of that definition, what we have is this is sigma prime. U of sigma contains X, but not Y, Z. Okay, let's write it this way. X is in U of sigma, but Y, Z is not in U of sigma. Because X is neighbor of Y and Z that already came before. So they are not in here, but X is here. But sigma prime, Y and G are both in here. Because Y is at first, there is nothing before it. And G has no neighbor between, I mean, G, Y is not neighbor of G. So it came first. But X is not in there. And then, we know that if we delete X, Y, G from this U sub sigma, and we also delete X, Y, G from U sub sigma prime, they should be equal. No matter what vertex we take here, if it's in U of sigma, then this also should be in U of sigma prime. Because all the thing comes before it is exactly same, and all the thing comes after it is exactly same. So, this is same, but at first stage, I mean, this only contains 1 out of 3, and this only contains 2 out of 3. So we know that this size is bigger than this size. So this choice and this choice give us different value of x. A contradiction to the assumption that x is a constant random variable. So which shows that this is disjoint union of complete graph. And then we didn't actually show that it has specific size, but that's, I mean, because we have this equality, that means this should be as equal as possible. So all the size of the complete graph are either Q or Q plus 1. So we get exactly this number. So that proves those two, I mean, theorem and proposition. And then the reason why we consider that was to study the embedding of complete graph into G. And then we take its complement. And we instead study this independent set because it's more comfortable to deal with that in our language of graph theory. So if we go back to its complement, then this theorem becomes the following. Oh yeah, before that, let's define this. Let T of Rn. So here we consider this disjoint union of cliques, disjoint union of complete graph. And then if we consider its complement, be the or O. Anyway, yeah, that's not important. If we consider its complement, then we get complete multipartite graph. So complete R-partite graph. Such that each part has size either floor over n over r or ceiling over n over r. So before we consider this disjoint union complete graph so that all the parts has size as equal as possible. Now we want to consider its complement. So we take complement of that, then all the between, we have edges. And the inside, we don't have edges. So we have this independent set of size as equal as possible. And between them, we have edges, I mean full edges. All the pairs, all the crossing pairs are edges. Then we call it a complete R partite graph. Because it's divided into R parts. So we say R parts each are independent set. So which is R partite graph. And we say complete if there are edges between. And let's say small t sub R n be the number of edges in this graph. Then it is easy to see that the complete graph on R plus 1 vertices does not embed into this complete R partite graph. Because if you choose R plus 1 vertices, then two of them must come from the same part, and there is no edge between. So this doesn't embed that. And moreover, by using that theorem, so remember this number of edges is exactly the complement, number of edges in this complement. So we can show that, let's, Turan's theorem that when n and r are all natural number with n being bigger than r plus 1, if g is an n vertex graph with more than the t sub r n for edges, then complete graph on r plus 1 vertices embedded into g. So this is exactly what we get by taking this theorem 1.3 and consider its complement. And if we take the proposition 1.4 and then we take its complement, then we consider the same. And if G is K sub R plus 1 free, so which means that it doesn't contain a copy of K sub R plus 1, the complete graph on R plus 1 vertices. And it contains exactly this many edges. Then G is isomorphic to this K sub R over N. So isomorphic means that it is same graph, up to labeling. So if you don't know what isomorphic means, is that it's just saying that G is this graph. So that shows the threshold on this E of G, which guarantees an embedding of complete graph. So if it contains more than this threshold, then it contains this complete graph on R plus 1 vertices. And if it's below, then it doesn't. And then we characterize, extremal graph, which contains the maximum number of edges, which doesn't contain this, complete graph on R plus 1 vertices. So there is one more tool that I want to introduce, so which is Cherenkov bound. Okay, I will write down and then explain. Suppose that we have some random variable, x1 to xn, which are independent. Which specify that it's either 0 or 1. And then we consider a random variable, which is sum of this random variable. And what we get is for all t, the probability that it's far away from its expectation is small. So here, what we did was we decomposed it into sums of simpler random variable, which was indicator random variable, which has value either 0 or 1. And then it was very useful to, deal with this f by, considering it as a sum of more simpler things. And then here, what we show is that its expectation is at least something. So with positive probability, we have certain structure. But later, it might be more difficult to, deal with it, it might be impossible to deal with it by just using this expectation alone. So we sometimes use this Chernoff inequality. So what it says is that if we flip a coin, let's say flip a coin, and if you have a head, then you write 1, and tail, you write 0. And then you flip a coin again, and you do that. And then you do it many times, say n times. And then you count the number of heads that you get. And we know that it's going to be very close to n over 2. So, if you don't believe me, then you can try it. But anyway, so that's exactly what this lemma describes. So if we flip this coin and then, we get with high probability, the number should be not exactly n over 2, but it should be somehow close to n over 2. So each xi is like each Turing course. Then they are independent. So first Turing course and second Turing course are irrelevant. First time you get head, and second time you get head, third time you get head. That doesn't mean fourth time you are more likely to get tail, right? Yeah, if you don't believe me, also go to casino and you can try it and you might lose some money, but anyway. So they are independent. Then, and we consider its sum. Then this sum should be very close to its expectation. So this measures the probability that it's at least t far from its expectation. Then that's exponentially small in terms of t. So later we have to deal with this situation when we want to, show that this x has certain value with certain probability and its sum with this many indicator random variable. Then we just compute this expectation. Then Chernoff inequality give us that with high probability, it's concentrated on the, its expected value. Yeah, I was gonna show some. Okay. Yeah. We have 10 more minutes. Okay. So let's give you some example of how we can use this to prove certain fact in graph theory. So assume n is big. So assume n is big is what it means is that there is some n0 and we only consider the case n is bigger than this n0. And let G be a, say, an n vertex graph. Then, say there exists a set U, which is a vertex offset of the disk G, with its size is close to n over 2. And for each vertex of G, the number of neighbors it has, the vertex has in U, let's say, yeah, there I wrote an inequality, but let's change it. So yeah, in the printout, it's inequality, but let's change it into equality. Yeah, I apologize for the, yeah, there will be many typos in this lecture note. So if you think something doesn't make sense, then yeah, you have to correct it yourself and understand. And you can let me know where it doesn't make sense. So here we write that A equals B plus minus C. It means that A is at least B minus C, and A is at most B plus C. So for this, we will just write in this way. So what it means is that when we have a graph G, then there exists a set vertex at U, which has size almost half, with plus minus a bit more. And then every vertex, the number of neighbors of this vertex, so this is set of neighbors. So if we have vertex and then say this is your graph, then n of g of b is exactly this vertices set, which is neighbor of this b. The number of neighbors of this b in u is almost half of its degree. So that's what this proposition says. And then in order to prove it, how do we do it? If we choose this set U, randomly, we randomly choose this set U, and then prove that this holds with the positive probability. So what you do is for each B, we add B to U with probability half independently at random. Then this U is random variable. Then what we can do is, yeah, for each B, let B sub I be the 1 or 0 if it's in U and if it's not in U. So as before, we decompose this into indicator random variable. Then we know that this I sub B are independent random variables, just like here. Because for this vertex and for this vertex, we flip a coin here, we flip a coin here. I mean, the outcome here doesn't affect the outcome here. Then what we know is the size of U is the sum of this indicator random variable for all vertices. Then what's the expectation? Expectation of each indicator random variable is half, because with probability half it's 1, probability half it's 0. So this is exactly half n. Then if you use this Zeleneff inequality, then what's the probability that it has size this? Then probability that U has size between n half minus n to the 2/3 and at most n half plus n to the 2/3 is at most 2 times e to the t squared is, here this is t, n to the 4 over 3 minus 2n, which is smaller than, say, 2 times e to the n to the 1/3 over 2. Ah, yeah. Good. Thank you. So this is not equal to that. It's exactly, so it's difference. So n over 2 is the expectation. And expectation minus x minus expectation, the absolute value is bigger than n to the 2 over 3 is exactly this. And then, let's say for, say, b, b is already used, so let's say u. What's the expected number of its number of neighbors in u? This is exactly for each u. No, u is fixed, so b. V, which is neighbor of u, we add its expectation of I sub u. So we have this I sub p, sorry. We have u fixed, and then it has neighbor, say four neighbors. Then for this, say v1, v2, v3, v4, then this expression, the number of neighbors of u in this set u, is exactly I sub v1 plus I sub v2 plus I sub v3 plus I sub v4. Because there are four neighbors. And then if it's included, then we count. If it's not included in u, we don't count. So this is exactly that. So this is exactly this. And then we take the expectation, then linearity of expectation gives this. Then this is exactly half of degree of u. So, by the same way, the Chernoff bound show that the number of neighbors in U, this vertex U's neighbor in the set U is not equal to its half times its degree plus minus n to the 2/3. It's smaller than 2 to the e negative n to the 4 over 3. Over 2 times its degree. And because degree is at most n, this is again 2 times e to the negative n to the 1/3 over 2. So we get some small probability that this doesn't satisfy. So we randomly select u, then the probability that has 2 big size or 2 small size is exponentially small. And for a certain vertex u, it has long number of neighbors inside of u, it's also small. Then, so here we have these two conditions, but it's actually more than two conditions. So there is this one condition, and for each b, for each vertex, we have this condition. So this is actually n conditions. So n conditions and one condition, we have n plus one conditions, right? Then probability that all of them satisfy is by using this and union bound. By union bound, all n plus one condition holds. So so by union bound, one of best condition holds with probability, say 2 to the e to the negative 1 over, negative n to the 1 over 3 over 2 times n plus 1 is the probability that at least one of bad events holds. None of them holds is 1 minus that. So all condition holds. So none of the bad events holds is probability at least this. This is polynomial. This is exponential. Exponentially decaying and polynomially increasing. And we assume that n is sufficiently large. Then, this goes to zero if n goes to infinity. So for certain n, if we take certain large n0 and then let n be bigger than n0, this is bigger than 0. That means there exists a choice of u which satisfies all these conditions. So which proves the proposition. So this is one typical example how we will use this Cherenkov lemma, Cherenkov inequality, to find certain structure or subgraph or sometimes vertex set or edge set which satisfy good property, which we will use later. So today we introduce what probabilistic method is, and we show that if G is dense enough, then we can embed a complete graph on R plus one vertices. And if it's smaller, so we found the threshold on the density on G. So number of edges on G, which guarantees an embedding of complete graph into G. So in this afternoon, we will learn more about the case when we are embedding this graph H, which is not complete. Then, what would be the, density threshold? So that's what we will do in the afternoon. So, yeah. So we will, this is for the morning lecture.